politically, her stature is diminishing fast. There's no doubt if she gets this coalition government going, she'll certainly lead it. She's said she wants to stay on for the full 4 years of the next term. Whether she ends up in that position for that amount of time, I would say is doubtful, but let's see.
Jenny Hill in Berlin, thank you. Unusual crops like the Estonian onion, potato and barley used to brew Irish beer. They're among the consignments of precious seeds which are being delivered to a vault in the Arctic Circle today. The delivery will take the number of seeds deposited in the global seed vault past the 1 million mark. For more, I'm joined by our science correspondent, Helen Briggs. Helen, so how significant is today's milestone in the history of the vault?
Well, some people call this the doomsday vault, so in the event of a disaster you could draw on these seeds to replace what's lost. It's like a big refrigerated library, but in place of books are the seeds that give us our wheat, our maize, our rice, our chickpeas, our lentils. So it is a milestone. The scientists behind it thought they would never get to the million mark a few years ago. But to put it into context, there are about 2.2 million unique varieties of crops out there. So they're about halfway to their goal of having a library of all the world's seeds protected in a vault that's earthquake-proof and sealed off against the elements.
And there's a big upgrade underway, isn't there?
That's right. Well, last year, because of extreme weather, there was some flooding to the entrance tunnel when the permafrost there melted. Now, the water got nowhere near the seeds. They were always safe. But there is this multi-million pound upgrade underway to prepare for a warmer, wetter future on the Arctic islands. New waterproof walls are being fitted to make sure water can never enter the actual vault, and a number of other repairs and upgrades.
Helen, thank you. Anti-government protests have been continuing in the Democratic Republic of Congo, where President Joseph Kabila is refusing to step down. His mandate expired in 2016. At least two protesters were killed on Sunday when security forces used live bullets on protesters. Meanwhile, thousands of people have been displaced by inter-ethnic violence. Now, correspondent Catherine Deruhanga has been to Ituri province in the northeast, where a bitter ethnic conflict is starting up again.
Most of the displaced are staying with friends, family and even strangers for opening their doors for them. Francoise Tumagamba is a 38-year-old mother of five. When the conflict began, she was constructing a mud house. It's not yet finished, but this is where 40 people are staying. Francoise has lived through war before and knows what it's like to run away from home with nothing. So she decided to help.
The government needs to assist them so that I can help them more. This place is out in the open and they feel cold. There is no mattress, no food, clothes or soap.
Thousands have crowded the government hospital. It's the only place to get support from aid agencies. In the DRC, nearly 5 million people have fled their homes because of a web of conflicts. It happens as President Joseph Kabila delays elections, leading to a growing power vacuum. Here in Ituri province, the violence is blamed on a long-standing ethnic rivalry between the Hema and Lendus. Dida Tikpa is a Lendu leader. And I put it to him that most of the killings and destruction are being blamed on the Lendus.
We noticed that Hema provoke a lot, disturb, and often the Lendu react. Unfortunately, sometimes beyond the provocation.
When you say provocation, what kind of things would Hema do to provoke such attacks?
Pour le cas d'espèce.
In this particular case, we've taken note, for example, of setting Lendu's house on fire. We have also taken note of pillages, for example, in the center of New.
Despite the cake, music and fancy clothes, it's a somber mood as Isaac Bamarachi weds his bride, Hajra. Isaac's father, Haj Ibrahim, tells me they've invited fewer people than they would have liked because of the insecurity. As president of the Hema community in Bunia, he's lived through various bouts of conflict with the Lendu. He says the Hema will fight back if the violence isn't brought to an end.
Kama government inashindwa kutuchunga sisi
Russia to fight each other. 20 years ago, it led to thousands of deaths. People here worry that if this conflict goes unchecked, it could spiral out of control. It's another growing conflict in a country sliding further into chaos.
Catherine Biruhanga reporting from the Democratic Republic of Congo. We'll have some other stories from our news desk.
The Indonesian authorities are bringing together 120 convicted Islamic militants with the victims of their terrorist attacks, giving the extremists a chance to apologize for their actions. The two groups will spend 3 days meeting in a Jakarta hotel. American filmmaker and comedian Kevin Smith says he only just survived a massive heart attack over the weekend. The 47-year-old, best known for the films Clerks and Chasing Amy, tweeted a picture of himself from a hospital bed covered with tubes. Smith had performed earlier that evening and was due to perform again but cancelled the second show. A new social media campaign has started highlighting the poor treatment of interns and junior staff by their bosses in the fashion industry. Those contributing to the Instagram post at Fashion Assistance say the bullying is often by women against women. Joe Ellison is the fashion editor of the Financial Times.
I think it's part of this new mode, I think, of using social media as a platform, as a public forum, so that people can air their grievances where they possibly don't have the usual apparatus of an organisation like an HR department or a union to represent them. I think people are turning to social media now to say, is this happening to you? And kind of creating a volley of dissent.
Now, we hear a lot of political interviews these days, but rarely are they called creepy. That's the word being applied to an Australian TV interview with the New Zealand Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern. To explain more, I'm joined by the newsroom's reporter Richard Hamilton. So, Richard, what did this interviewer say that caused such a stir?
Well, thanks, Alex. May I just start by saying how attractive you're looking this morning? Because that is how the veteran broadcaster in Australia, Charles Woolley, started his interview with the New Zealand Prime Minister, Jacinda Ardern. It was on the Channel 9 programme, 60 Minutes. And in his opening remarks, he said, I've met a lot of prime ministers in my time. Charles Woolley is in his early 70s. And he said, but none so young and not so many so smart and never one so attractive. And then it was recently announced that Ms. Ardern is pregnant. So he then carried on with this line of questioning.
One really important political question I want to ask you, and that is, what exactly is the date the baby's due?
17th of June.
17th. It's interesting how much people have been counting back to the conception of the 20th. having produced six children, it doesn't amaze me that people can have children. Why shouldn't a child be conceived during an election campaign?
The election was done.
It was
over.
The child is...
Not that we need to get into those details.
The child is steeped in politics.
Okay, so that's a clip from the interview, and there's been quite a reaction on social media.
That's right. Mainly women, but also some men as well, from Australia and New Zealand. Someone said, why did 60 Minutes send its creepiest interviewer to do its segment on Jacinda Ardern? Another one, these are all on Twitter, says commenting on her level of attractiveness doesn't seem to be at all relevant to her ability as a nation's leader. Another person says, on behalf of those Australians who are not sexist pigs, I sincerely apologise for trash television. We're a bit behind over here. Another person said, I assumed 60 Minutes would have a second half of the Jacinda interview after the break that discussed her policies and political achievements, but we got nothing. All we got was sexist comments about her looks and baby talk. Absolutely. And then there's a word which we can't broadcast, and then journalism. And she says, changes channel. And then an Australian media academic, she says, dear New Zealand, our best mate, you know how everyone has a creepy uncle you need to avoid at Christmas parties? Sorry, we got him to interview your Prime Minister. Please tell Jacinda Ardern we reckon it was gross. And Channel 9 has defended its programme, saying it wanted to show the human side of its interviewees, and Charles Woolley himself has described it as an Orwellian backlash.
And Jacinda Ardern herself said, well, this is no big deal, but there is a sort of sense she was being quite polite.
Yes, in that clip you could almost feel her toes curling in her shoes, and her husband seems a bit embarrassed as well, so not perhaps the best broadcast.
The newsroom's most attractive reporter, if I may say, Richard Hamilton, ending this edition of the newsroom. Plenty more, of course.